Hello, dear students. Today we'll be discussing regarding the topic that is traction in orthopedics. So first, the definition of the traction. So a traction is the application of a force to stretch certain parts of the body in a specific direction. As we can see here, this is your right lower limb. This is your femur. Here, this is your tibia here. So if there's a fracture in this part, that is the femur, then we are applying the traction on the lower part, and the traction is pulling the body in a specific direction. Coming to the principles, so whenever there is a painful condition in any part of the body as a result of inflammation or a joint dislocation or a fracture. So as we can see here, there is a fracture in the shaft of the femur. So due to this painful condition, the controlling muscles go into a spasm. Spasm is a involuntary contraction of a muscle or a group of muscles. So this is your abductors, these are your adductors. So whenever there is a fracture, as we see here, there will be friction, there will be pain, there will be inflammation. So the muscles go into spasm, like the adductors and the abductors. So what happens due to that is, the more powerful muscles make the limb go into a deformity. So as we can see here, we can see a deformity. This limb has gone into a flexion, and it will also go into abduction on this part and adduction on this part. So the antagonistic muscles, that is the opposing muscles in a limb, are not all equally powerful, with the result that when muscle spasm is present, the action of the more powerful muscles can produce a deformity, which may seriously impair the future function of the limb. So that's why we apply the traction to overcome the deformity and reduce the fracture or dislocation of a joint. So as we can see in this picture, when the traction is applied, the fracture is reduced and the deformity is gone. So to summarize it, whenever there is inflammation of a joint or there is pain and muscle spasm, that leads to deformity. Or if there is a fracture of a bone, there is abnormal mobility which leads to pain and leads to deformity. So the traction prevents the deformity. So what are the indications of a traction? Indications of a traction are, it is used to reduce a fracture, it is used to reduce the dislocation of a joint, it is sometimes can be used for immobilization to relieve the pain, to rest the limb in the functional position. So whenever there is a deformity, the limb has to be rested in a functional position so as to prevent the deformity. It can also be used for aiding the healing of the bone, or overcome muscle spasm and deforming forces, and correction of soft tissue contractures. Coming to the principles of traction care, so when we apply the traction, we have to consider some principles. So we have to maintain the established line of pull. So there should be a continuous established line of pull. There should be continuous traction. There should be a counter traction. Counter traction is the opposing force as of a traction against which the force is applied. We have to maintain the traction equipment. We have to keep it in a working condition. We have to maintain correct body alignment so as to prevent deformity, and we have to prevent the friction of the skin so that the complications doesn't occur. So coming to the types of traction, the traction can be applied directly to the skin or through the bone. So if it's applied through the skin, then it's a skin traction. If it's applied through the bone, that is known as a skeletal traction. Here we can see, this is a skin traction. This is a skin traction. This is also skin traction. We can see here the pin is applied through the bone. So this is a skeletal traction. Coming to the skin traction, so the basic part is that the skin traction, in skin traction we cannot apply a larger force as the skin will excoriate or the skin will peel off. So the traction is applied over a large area. This spreads the load and is more comfortable and efficient. So this is more easier, and the traction is applied over a large area, as we can see here. The maximum traction that can be applied is 7 kg. Actually, it is 6.7 kg, but approximately comes to around 7 kg. There are two types of skin traction. That is adhesive skin traction and non-adhesive skin traction. In adhesive skin traction, we use a adhesive material, something similar to our Fevicol or something. And in non-adhesive skin traction, we just apply the bandage over the limb and press it. So what are the indications of skin traction? It is used for temporary management of femoral neck fractures and intertrochanteric fractures. Can also be used for management of femoral shaft fractures. Can be used for undisplaced fractures of the acetabulum. It can be used for after reduction of a dislocation of a hip joint. It can be used to prevent minor fixed flexion deformities of the hip or knee. The word minor is important because not a weight above 7 kg cannot be applied. So major deformities cannot be corrected with this. It can also be used for management of low backache, and also can be used after amputation to approximate the skin tissue. What are the contraindications of the skin traction? Skin traction cannot be used if there is abrasion of the skin, if there is a laceration of the skin, if there is impairment of circulation such as venous ulcers, there is venous stasis, there is gangrene, or there is dermatitis of the skin, or if there is a marked shortening of the bony fragments, as a higher weight cannot be applied. What are the complications of skin traction? There can be allergic reaction to the adhesive. There can be excoriation of the skin, like we can see here. There can be pressure sores or ulcers around the malleolus and over the tendocalcaneus. Or there can be a common peroneal nerve palsy, which can lead to foot drop. That's a very common complication if the proper precautions are not taken. So there are some common examples of the skin traction. You just need to know the name. It can be a Buck's traction, it can be Hamilton-Russell traction, it can be a Tulloch-Brown traction, it can be a Gallows or Brand's traction, it can be modified Brand's traction, it can be a pelvic traction, or it can be a Dunlop traction. Then coming to the skeletal traction. In skeletal traction, as we can see here, we pass a pin through the bone. So for skeletal traction, a metal pin or wire is driven through the bone. By this means, the traction force is applied directly to the skeleton. Skeletal traction is seldom necessary in the management of upper limb fractures. In upper limb fractures, we generally use a skin traction as not much of the force is required. In lower limb traction, we require generally a higher force, so skeletal traction is preferred. So it is used frequently in the management of lower limb fractures. It should be reserved for those cases in which skin traction is contraindicated. A very serious complication of skeletal traction can be a bony infection. This is a very dreadful complication. So it is used only when required. So there are few instruments that we use to apply the skeletal traction. First is the Steenman pin. A Steenman pins are rigid stainless steel pins of varying lengths from 4 to 6 millimeters in diameter. After insertion, a special instrument is applied to the pin that is known as a bowler stirrup. So this Steenman pin and bowler stirrup both act in concert to each other. The bowler stirrup allows the direction of the traction to be varied without turning the pin in the bone. So this is your Steenman pin. This is the pointed end. This is the blunt end. As we can see, the shaft is having no serrations and no threads. This is a bowler stirrup. So this part goes through this part and it comes out like this. And the traction is applied. We'll see it in the next diagram. So this is your bolus stirrup along with your Stedman pin. And coming to Denham's pin. So the main difference between Stedman pin and Denham's pin is the threads. We can see here or in this inset is a thread. So the Denham pin is identical to a Stedman pin except for a short threaded length situated towards the middle. This threaded portion engages the bony cortex and reduces the risk of pin sliding. So this part stays in the bone and this doesn't allow the pin to slide off. So this type of pin is particularly suitable for use in cancerous bones such as calcaneus or in osteoporotic bones. Then coming to Kirschner wire or K wire. So the difference between a Kirschner wire and a Stedman pin is that a K wire or a Kirschner wire has tips at, or sorry, is sharp at both ends. Okay. So the Stedman pin was sharp at one end and other end was blunt. And the K wire are of lower diameter. It is not generally used to apply skeletal traction. It is generally used to reduce fractures, but it can be used to apply skeletal traction. So Kirschner wire is of smaller diameter and of low strength. The wire easily cuts out of the bone if a heavy traction weight is applied, as it is very fragile or lower in diameter. Although Kirschner wire can be used in the lower limb, they are most often used in the upper limbs or in pediatric ages. So skeletal traction can be applied in the following parts: in the upper tibial, in the lower femoral part, in the upper femoral part, lower tibial part, calcaneum, olecranon and metacarpal. We'll see all of this in detail. So in lower end of femur, so this is the point of insertion in lower end of femur. There are two methods that can be applied to determine the entry point. First is a line is drawn from anterior to posterior direction from the upper end of the patella, like this line, and a second line is drawn just flush to the anterior part of the fibula. So where these two lines meet is the point of insertion. This is your first method. Or second method is just proximal to the upper limit of the lateral femoral condyle. So if this is your lateral femoral condyle, this is ending here, so it is just proximal, 1 or 2 centimeter proximal to the upper end of lateral femoral condyle, around 3 centimeters. Okay. In upper end of tibia, the point is your tibial tuberosity. So it has to be 2 centimeter posterior and 2 centimeter inferior to the tibial tuberosity. So it has to be applied from lateral to medial direction, as you have common peroneal nerve on the upper end of fibula. So it can be damaged if you put it blindly from medial to lateral side. So it has to be from lateral to medial side, 2 centimeter posterior and inferior to the tibial tuberosity. So in lower end of tibia, this is your insertion point. So it is very easy. It is just 2 centimeter above the level of the ankle joint, midway between the anterior and posterior borders of the tibia. So you take the tip of the lateral malleolus, you go 2 centimeter above it. Sorry, you take ankle joint as your marking. You go 2 centimeter above it and midway between the anterior and the posterior points of the tibia. This is the insertion point in lower end of tibia. And coming to the calcaneum, so you take lateral malleolus as your reference point. You go 2 centimeter below and 2 centimeter posterior. So this will be your insertion point. So it has to be 2 centimeter posterior and below the tip of the lateral malleolus. Then coming to upper limb, olecranon. So in olecranon, it has to be 3 centimeters distal to the tip of the olecranon. So this is your tip of the olecranon. This is your insertion point. So in here, like in upper end of tibia, here also there is a specific direction we have to follow. So it has to be passed from medial to lateral direction as so as to avoid the injury to the ulnar nerve. So, and in coming to the metacarpals, this is not very commonly applied, but you should know it. So it is applied through the second and the third metacarpal, just 2 to 2.5 centimeter below the metacarpophalangeal joint. So this is your direction, this is your pin. It has to be 2 to 2.5 centimeter, that is around an inch proximal to the metacarpophalangeal joint. In upper end of femur, it is used in the central dislocation, fracture dislocation of the hip or fracture of the acetabulum undisplaced. Cancellous screw or screw eye is applied. So it is 2.5 cm below the tip of the greater trochanter. This is the tip of the greater trochanter. So it has to be 2.5 cm below and midway between the anterior and posterior cortex. There are some complications that can also happen in skeletal traction. First and the most important is the infection. If there is an infection in a bone, then it is a very problematic condition for both the surgeon and the patient. So infection can happen. There can be incorrect placement of the pin, so that can lead to cutting out of the pin, and the control of the rotation of the limb becomes very difficult, and application of the spring become very difficult, and unequal pull causes the pin to move in the bone, causing ischemic necrosis. And in skeletal traction, if we use too much force, a larger force, that can cause distraction at the fracture site, can cause ligament damage also. There can be damage to the epiphyseal growth plate in children. This will lead to deformity, can lead to a varus, valgus, or a rotational deformity in children, or can be a shortening or lengthening also. This can lead to big scars, depression of the depressed scars, and stiffness of the joint also. So this completes our lecture for today. Thank you very much.